Hi, welcome to Cyber Guidance. And in this video, I will be displaying a real-life scenario of a cybersecurity incident. And I would also walk you through how I investigate this incident as a cybersecurity analyst. So make sure you watch this video to the end, because everything that I will be demonstrating is actually based on a real-life scenario. Like, this happened to my client, and I thought it is nice to create an awareness about this. So let's dive in. How did this incident occur? This incident happened when my client received the email that she got a file. And then, you know, a lot of people are curious when they get this kind of emails. The next thing she did was she opened the file and then she downloaded it. And that was when things got serious. So we got this incident. And first thing I did was to assign the security incident to myself, and I put it on active. That way, my colleagues already know someone is busy with this incident. Next thing is, I need to check the entities, and entities are basically everything that makes up this alert. As you can see, we've got this executable, we've got the login data, we've got the file hash, and the name of the incident, possible theft of passwords and other sensitive web browser information. Without wasting much time, I went straight into the XDR, which is the extended detection response, which is where I can further investigate this incident and gain more insight about what happened. While I am doing this, my colleague already called the client to understand what happened. What did she do? Did she click on any executable, or did she know the sender that sent this email? Just to get up more analysis, you know, that can help us with the investigation. I clicked on evidence on response to see what are the verdicts. As you can see here, we've got EXE executable, we've got the login data, and basically this already tells me that this client has been breached, because login data are where your passwords are being stored. So if you save your browser info, or if you save your credentials in your browser, it all goes to the login data, which is being stored in your device. So there is a possibility. I don't know yet. I still need to investigate. And this is a high alert. It's something that is critical. I don't want to take that risk of, you know, spending much time on this incident. And the next thing I am going to do is try to isolate this device. But before isolating the device, it is always important to inform the user. And while I am isolating the device, one of my colleagues, you know, is already speaking with the client and letting the client know that we would be isolating your device because we suspect a malicious file inside your device. So you need to give us 10 minutes or 20 minutes. When we are done, we would release the device for you. So I went ahead to isolate the device. And what this means basically is that the device would be out of the network. So the threat actor cannot move laterally within the tenant. So you just need to give a comment why malicious. Anyways, I don't want to isolate this device yet, but this is what you would do, and make sure you inform the user. There are also some situations whereby you cannot get in touch with the user, but you know, better to be safe than sorry. Just go ahead, isolate it, and then the next thing you want to do is to run a full antivirus scan before you even start investigating. So that way, if there is any malicious file inside the device, it can, you know, wipe it off. You also give your reasons. Malicious file. And then you can click on confirm. Windows Defender would do its thing. So while you've done that, or while I did that already, the next thing I want to do is to check if there is maybe any sign-in risk. However, this already tells me it's more on a device level than a user risk. It's more on a device risk. level. So I can try to watch or just look at this attack path to kind of understand what happened. And here I can already see that it says PowerShell executed a script. It says explorer.exe moved file, multi-browser credential.exe. It says discord.py, discord.txt, my icon.ico. So I can already tell that this executable was embedded into this myicon.ico ICO. And here it says true positive, possible theft of power of passwords. If I come down here, as you can see, this file is not signed. So that tells me a lot. Next thing I want to do is to check this file. I would go back to evidence and response and check this file. If I can check the file hash, if it's maybe if it has been reported already. So I can go on virus total. Check this hash. Okay, no information. One thing you also need to know, or one thing I learned about this incident, is that most of this possible theft of passwords and sensitive web browser are from a family called InfoStealer. And this InfoStealer, it changes because most of these scripts are written, it's not just the same pattern. So you might get some that has been reported already, and there's still a possibility that you'll get some that is just new. It's almost like a zero day. So you have to just deal with it. And next thing I did after running the antivirus scan and checking the file hash is to block this executable. So that way, if anyone within the organization has the same file, it would block the file from running. And even if they try to download it, it's already been added as an indicator, so it's blocked. So this is part of the response, the measures that I take. So I'll just give it a title, malicious file. Give it a description, suspicious, you know, something. Never expire, click on next, block and remediate, next, I just want to put it as information now, I'll say credential access, next, and submit. So this is good because now we've blocked this file and then we've added it as an indicator. Next thing I want to do is to go into the device timeline just to see if there is any information I can get about this file, or basically what happened and how did the user click on this executable. While I am doing this, my colleague was speaking with the client and trying to let the client know that they have been breached, or she has been breached, and it is safe for her to reset her passwords and set up MFA, which is really compulsory. So we are going to select one of the incidents, and then here we can just, you know, look at the timeline of what happened. Here it says attempted to decrypt credentials, access browser saved password for file, login data. So this is true positive because the credentials has been stolen already. So which is why we also need to inform the user and, you know, change your password immediately, all your passwords. Now that I've gathered this analysis and I can already tell that this is a true positive based on what I have seen on this device timeline. Next thing is to find a solution to prevent this from happening again. And as a security analyst, you need to be proactive. So what are examples of or ways which I can prevent this from happening to protect my user. And one thing I realized is the use of WDAC, which is Windows Defender for Application Control. I think if we check it here. Windows Defenders for Application Control. So this will check for unsigned certificates of in any application that is not signed and Microsoft does not recognize it as a legitimate file. So I can just see what is WDAC. Yeah, so it is a security feature of Microsoft and it uses code integrity policies to restrict what code can run. So this file, it's not signed. It's not a signed, it doesn't have a signed certificate. If you check here, as you can see here, it says unknown. So at Debian, we had WDAC deployed. It would have prevented the user from running this executable. So this is one advice I would also give to my colleague, and then we can implement WDAC. Next thing I also did is to check if this file is still in the device, and I also check if this email was sent to other users in the tenant. That way I can proactively also investigate other users, or just to know if maybe the executable has been sent to a lot. And who knows, it's always good to be proactive as a security analyst. So in order to check that, I can always come to email and collaboration. I can click on explorer, and basically that was what I did. Unfortunately, nobody else received this email, so which is quite good. And then you can always check that from just copy this, and then you can click on sender address, paste it. See, there are multiple users that received this same email. It's just one, so basically it's still the same user. And if you want to know if the user clicked on it, you can always click on top clicks or URL clicks. And next thing is, I want to know if this user or if this executable is still in the device. And what I can do is just to device details. You can open the device page, and then you can do a live response. Let's investigate. Initiate, yeah, live response session. And there you can just, check the file path. You can basically sign in into the user's device, and there you can check if the executable is still in the desktop. So here you can, just see the users, and then you keep going till you check if the executable is still inside the device. And as soon as I'm done, or soon I was done with that, next thing I did was to gather my analysis and close the incident, set it to true positive, and then just put in everything that I have investigated, that I noticed, or what happened, what I did. I write everything in the comments, and then you just click on apply. That way you've closed the incident. So I hope you gained some insight about in this video, and I would appreciate if you can subscribe or if you can like.